everybody, I'm Garth Brooks. And what you're about to see is a very unique story about the longest running live radio show in history. It's been going on every weekend now, from week to week, generation to generation, for 75 years. It's the Grand Ole Opry. But this isn't just about a radio show. As a business, the Grand Ole Opry is an amazing success story. As a stage show, it's a cultural phenomenon. But what's most important of all this, as an icon of history, the Grand Ole Opry is an American tradition like no other.
Please help me make welcome the one and only Vince Steele, ladies and gentlemen.
Charlie Pride. Would you like to be his
ladies and gentlemen, the coal miner's daughter, Loretta Lynn.
Miss Trisha Yearwood.
Alan Jackson.
Here, Jimmy Baker.
Mr. Steve Warner.
The incredible talents of Reba McEntire.
Miss Jean Shepherd.
A great big hand for my buddy and yours, Mr. Garth Brooks.
For every country musician who dreams of being a star, this is their mark, a well-worn circle of wood, center stage at the Grand Ole Opry.
That's square one. That is where the heart and soul of country music starts.
Isn't that something? I try not to stand on that circle no more than I have to. I cross it pretty fast and I go back because I know that's where Hank Williams stood.
I got the lovesick blues.
Patsy.
Crazy for feet.
So, Marty Robbins, the greatest. They were the greatest, and that's where they stood.
Bill Monroe stood there. Lester Flatt and Earl Scruggs stood there.
You don't pass over that spot in the floor and not get a chill.
That's the only place in the world that I'm a nervous wreck, Sagan. It really is.
If I don't control my knees, I'm just going to fall over. And my knees are shaking so hard.
It definitely makes your knees knock.
If you're not nervous, it doesn't mean what it ought to mean to you. Because the Grand Ole Opry to a country singer or performer is what Yankee Stadium is to a baseball player, or what Hollywood or Broadway is to an actor or an actress. And if you're not nervous, there's something wrong with you. You don't belong out there if you're not nervous the first time.
Well, there's a real interesting kind of nervousness that has never gone away from me. And I think that's, you know, maybe some sort of spirit from everything that's gone on in that circle.
To know who has come across that stage before you all these years, going back to 1925, it's awesome.
For 75 years and counting, the Grand Ole Opry has featured a cavalcade of country music stars performing live every weekend, rain or shine, at 6:50 on the AM radio dial. In the year 2000, the longest-running radio show in history has added a brand new look. There's a new set with the most sophisticated stage lighting in the world. Huge TV screens the whole audience can see. And a cast of stars. From Porter Wagoner to Trisha Yearwood. Along with two more members, Pam Tillis.
I like the idea of having a place to come back to.
And bluegrass legend, Ralph Stanley.
You know, I think most anybody that's in the music business, that's their dream, you know, to get to the Grand Ole Opry.
Tillis and Stanley may be new members, but they aren't new to the music business or the Opry. Pam was literally born to the stage, daughter of country star Mel Tillis. And Ralph Stanley has graced the Opry for more than 50 years.
It seems to me there has always been at least three generations represented here. Where else can you go other than maybe a theater production where you see three generations working together? Putting on a show. We're very unique.
And that's what the Grand Ole Opry is all about. Family. Home. Respect. Great entertainment. And history. It's a unique American tradition. The authentic home of country music.
It's timeless. You can come here and you gain a perspective of not just what's current today in country music. You can come out here and hear the songs your grandparents maybe have played you, your parents maybe have played you. That's pretty neat, you know, to hear that much history.
Today, the Opry's not just on the radio. It's live on television and on the internet at opry.com.
The advent of the internet and webcasting really represents an exciting opportunity for the Opry, much like AM radio did in 1925. In the year 2000, we streamed the audio broadcast from the Opry for the first time over the internet. And just like the founders in 1925, we're using the technology of our day to present the Opry this time around the world.
And because it is a live show, every weekend is different. Every performance is unique.
It can be very spontaneous on this stage. And that's, I think, also what makes it wonderful. And mistakes are made out on this stage. I can tell you, I made plenty. But I think that's the beauty of it.
The thing that really inspired me about the Opry was all of its members were stars. They were famous people.
I think every night at the Opry is all-star night, because you never know. The fact of the matter is, you know, they have a scheduled performance list every night. But I've been known to drop in on other performers, and that happens all the time. You never know who's liable to pop in, because obviously this is Music City, USA.
With four shows every weekend and 15 to 20 different acts on each show, just about anything can happen on the Opry, and usually does.
We never know until the middle of the week who's going to be on the show, and I check that roster regularly to see who's going to be on, and especially on my particular portions of the opera.
There's some sort of surprise almost every week on the Opry. Vince Gill, he typically will call in and just say, hey, like to swing by, play the Opry.
We all got our starts playing on the stage of the Grand Ole Opry for the first time, playing bluegrass music. While country.
In my heart, I owe it to them. I owe it to Porter Wagoner. I owe it to Roy Acuff. I owe it to Jimmy Dickens. I owe it to Patsy Cline, Jim Reeves, whoever. You know, all those people taught me how to do this. And I think it's a matter of respect to be out here. But it's also, it's a blast.
There's a few of us that just absolutely love the Opry, and we're going to be there every time we can and promote it and do things for it as we can. It's something that makes me proud. I'm a member of the Grand Ole Opry. I'm a member of the oldest running radio show in America, and I'm a member of Heritage.
It's a tremendous place, so full of love, so full of history, and it's my home.
Yeah, it's a real special club, and it's not just people from the last decade or the last 20 years, 30 years, I mean, 75 years worth of entertainers. I just wish I could go back in time and meet a lot of them.
Everyone had a lot of fun at the Grand Ole Opry tonight.
The Grand Ole Opry, 75 years of America's music, continues in a moment on A&E.
75 years of America's music on A&E.
The American phenomenon that is known worldwide as the Grand Ole Opry began somewhat accidentally because of a series of unplanned events that occurred in 1925. On the fifth floor of this office building in downtown Nashville, Tennessee.
Well, to understand the origin of Grand Ole Opry, you have to discuss the National Life and Accident Insurance Company, which was the founding company of WSM Radio.
In 1925, Edwin Craig, a young National Life executive, had an idea.
Edwin Craig was a radio hobbyist. He was the 1920s equivalent of a computer geek. Radio was the computer of the 20s, I suppose. And he would sit up late at night and listen to ship-to-shore transmissions. He built radio receivers and transmitting equipment.
Radio in 1925 was very new. Many people didn't believe radio was anything more than a gadget. And the people who owned the National Life, the older gentlemen who were in charge of it, didn't think radio would ever amount to anything. But young Edwin Craig liked it.
He convinced the board of directors to construct a radio studio and put in the equipment to start WSN.
When they built the station, the people at National Life did agree on one thing. They wanted to build the best station that money could buy, because that was their style.
Many early radio stations in America used call letters to identify company slogans.
WSM stands for the National Life and Accident Insurance Company's motto, "We Shield Millions." And WSM had to be the call letters for the new radio station that went on the air on October 5th, 1925.
Broadcasting 1,000 watts at 650 kilohertz, WSM became the second most powerful station in the South and could be heard by listeners for hundreds of miles around Nashville. The first strains of music heard over WSM were formal, catering to the classics, not country. There was opera, brass bands, and parlor music. There were readings of prose, poetry, and the gospel, all according to the tastes of Nashville's proper society.
It looked at first as if this radio station were going to be simply another plaything for the upper middle class of Nashville, the old Nashville aristocracy, the old Nashville money, the people who like to call Nashville the Athens of the South. And then all that changed in a rather dramatic way. They hired to run their station a young man named George Dewey Hay.
George D. Hay was a radio pioneer in his own right, best known by his self-styled moniker, the Solemn Old Judge.
He was not especially solemn, he was not especially old, and he certainly wasn't a judge.
Hay arrived at WSM in the fall of 1925. It was the height of the Roaring Twenties, when flappers and bathtub gin fueled the jazz age. Amidst this, Hay asked himself, what can I do to give this station a sense of identity?
As he was thinking about it, an accident occurred. One night in November of 1925, one of the people who was supposed to speak suddenly had to cancel. So the station was faced with the most horrible thing that any station back in those days of live radio could be faced with, dead air.
Hay immediately turned to his staff pianist, a charming, well-educated musician named Eva Thompson Jones.
She stepped in and started playing some light classical music on the piano. During the break, she asked young George Hay, how long do I have to go? And he said, well, it looks like you might have to kill an hour. And she said, oh, wow. She said, well, look, she says, my uncle is waiting in my car downstairs for me. In fact, he plays the violin. He could even help me make some music. So pretty soon up the stairs comes this white-bearded 78-year-old gentleman. And Judge Hay looked at him and said, what is it you have there? And he takes out this beautiful, very, very old fiddle. And he says, this is old Betsy, and we're going to play some tunes.
And the old geezer was a hit. They got mail from supposedly every state in the union.
And this was very interesting to Hay, because it taught him something he had not realized up until that point. Namely, that WSM reached out far beyond the confines of the Nashville city limits. and that the people in these outlying areas, they like this fiddle and banjo music, and that maybe if he brought in people like Uncle Jimmy on a regular basis, he could find an entirely new audience that nobody had suspected, and an entirely new niche for WSM to play.
George D. Hay recognized at once that he had a hit concept on his hands. And when people heard Uncle Jimmy on the air, other rural musicians came to the station, and he eagerly began building a cast.
So pretty soon, what happens is that on Saturday night at the National Life Building, all of a sudden we've got all these people trooping up the stairs. They're wanting to watch the radio show, but a lot of them want to do more than watch it. They want to be on the show. And so suddenly, George Hay finds himself besieged with this small army of musicians from out in the country. And he said, what we had on our hands was a good-natured riot.
Within a matter of weeks, Hay had a regular cast, including Uncle Jimmy Thompson, Uncle Dave Makin, several excellent string bands, and a harmonica wizard named D. Ford Bailey. Around this nucleus, Hay deliberately cultivated a hillbilly image.
It is said that Judge Hay would, in his spare time, sit in his office and make up outlandish names for bands. And he would keep this list in his desk drawer. One of the bands that showed up to play, for example, was a band led by Dr. Humphrey Bate. And he announced that his band was called Dr. Humphrey Bate and his Amalgamated String Band Orchestra. And George Hay just kind of shook his head at that and said, no, we can't do that. Let's call you Dr. Humphrey Bate and his Possum Hunters.
Hay came up with names like the Fruit Jar Drinkers and the Dixie Clodhoppers. But some bands had names that even Hay said he couldn't improve, such as the Crook Brothers. But if he didn't change their names, he changed their appearances, dressing them all up like country bumpkins.
Most country musicians at that time would have performed in proper suits and ties because they want to be taken seriously. But Hay dressed them in overalls and hazy get-ups to make them seem like authentic rustics, and thereby gave the show its ambiance, its style.
I think that was the key. He sensed what would appeal to the American people.
In 1927, about 2 years after Hay's arrival and the beginning of the Saturday Night Barn Dance, WSM became an affiliate of the NBC radio network and began featuring live programs from New York. One show was a classical program called the Music Appreciation Hour, under the direction of conductor Walter Damrosch. This hour led directly into Hay's barn dance. One Saturday, Damrosch introduced his last song of the night by saying that there was no room in the classics for realism.
Well, Hay had picked up on that because his group was assembling in the studio, and this sound of the Music Appreciation Hour was coming through the monitors, and Hay, when he took the air with WSM Barn Dance, said, and I'm paraphrasing here, there may not be any room in classical music for reality, but we're going to get down to earth now. You've been listening to selections largely taken from Grand Opera, but from here on out, it'll be Grand Ole Opry.
And it stuck. The name stuck. And stuck immediately. As really, the very next week in the newspaper, they're calling it Grand Ole Opry.
From that day forward, the Grand Ole Opry at the ripe age of two was regarded, for better or worse, as a genuine homegrown American institution.
This is WSM Nashville, Tennessee, presenting the Grand Ole Opry. Let her go, boys.
The Grand Ole Opry, 75 years of America's music, continues in a moment on A&E.
75 years of America's music on A&E.
By 1928, the solemn old judge, George D. Hay, had fully established the format of his little Saturday night radio show on WSM. It was the Grand Ole Opry, featuring a regular cast of colorful characters, with Hay himself leading the band.
George D. Hay was more than an announcer. Yes, he was a radio announcer. But he was really a personality. He was the master of ceremonies. I liken George D. Hay to Ed Sullivan. He was the man who introduced all the stars.
Hay blew a steamboat whistle to kick off every show.
Howdy, friends. Welcome to the Grand Ole Opry, the capital of country music throughout the world. Let her go, boys!
It was part of his stick, as they say. I don't know that anybody's ever claimed he had anything to do with steamboating on rivers, but he was a character.
Welcome, everybody, everywhere. Pull off your shoes and pull up a chair. Roses are red, violets are blue. I'm craving music, and I'll bet you are, too. Boy, did you...
Hay became famous for his homilies. The Grand Ole Opry, he'd say, was simple as sunshine, a right good slice of America as she is. And in the same vein, he promoted his stars. Of Uncle Jimmy Thompson, Hay boasted, he could fiddle the taters off the vine.
You know, if I had to pick one instrument that drove the Opry, it would probably be the fiddle. Because the very first song ever played on the Opry was Uncle Jimmy Thompson, who did a fiddle tune.
As for Uncle Dave Macon, the Opry's first banjo man, Hay called him the Dixie Dewdrop and the grand old man of the Grand Ole Opry.
The first person who became featured besides Uncle Jimmy was Uncle Dave Macon, an incredibly entertaining guy, just hilarious, you know, twirled his banjo, cracked jokes, was, you know, just a delight, just a real scream. And the people loved it, and that attracted more.
That's what started the Opry to me. It was country people. Uncle Dave Macon, Uncle Jimmy Thompson, people that played on their front porch. Dave Macon playing music, flipping his banjo around. I mean, he was the first star. He was the first superstar of the Grand Ole Opry. And to see, you know, his show and to see him flip and spin, you know, that banjo around and throw his leg up and do all these great, I mean, my God, it would have just been the coolest thing in the world to have gotten to see that live.
At first, there wasn't supposed to be an audience. But when people just started showing up in the National Life Building to see the radio show, Hay and the executives at WSM decided they had to accommodate the crowd. So the show was moved, twice in fact, to bigger studios in the building. And thus, the program evolved quite early in its run into a stage show. Other changes brought more growth. The executives at National Life invested heavily in WSM, steadily increasing the station's broadcast power from 1,000 to 5,000 and eventually to 50,000 watts.
The Opry brass, the National Life people, wanted this station to be top-notch, first class all the way. So in 1932, they petitioned for 50,000-watt clear channel status and constructed what was then the tallest radio tower in the world. That allowed the show to be beamed to all 50 states on a clear channel frequency.
Clear channel radio is a phenomenon that a lot of people today don't realize how powerful it was. That simply meant that no other radio station could be on 650 on the dial. So it put out a tremendous signal. And it was at nighttime that signal spread the furthest.
Well, you could hear it just about anywhere. So many people were influenced by that music, not only in the South, but all over this country.
As WSM's power grew, so did its audience for the Grand Ole Opry. Like pilgrims heading for Mecca, country people came to Nashville every Saturday night.
The crowds that came
downtown for the Grand Ole Opry were just incredible. And they would fill the studio, and they would pack the hallways of the National Life Building and spill out onto the streets.
That didn't sit well with the high society in the so-called Athens of the South.
But there's always been a gap between the upper crust of Nashville and the Grand Ole Opry. I'm not so sure that there wasn't a time when the elite society of Nashville was not a bit of ashamed of those hillbillies down there on Saturday night doing what they did. But the beautiful part is the hillbillies didn't care.
This presented a great quandary to the folks at National Life. WSM had proved to be a financial gold mine. Selling radio time for advertising had blossomed overnight, adding unforeseen profits to the company's balance sheet. But the real wealth of the station was the Grand Ole Opry itself, which gave National Life insurance agents a powerful calling card across America.
It was a door opener for us, and worked very, very well, because the Opry's always had that the seal of good housekeeping, and that if it's connected with the Opry, it had to be good. So it was a boon to us.
Because of this, the executives of National Life made a conscious decision to ignore the complaints of their friends in Nashville society.
They said, okay, if they don't like it, that's tough. In the words of Ricky Skaggs, they can pray about it and get over it. But we're going on with this show. And they did.
Then, another accident changed the Opry's course.
On a particular Saturday night, this National Life executive stopped by the building to get some important papers from his office and couldn't get through the crowd to get to his office. And he was so incensed about it that the next Monday morning, it was demanded that the Grand Ole Opry either go away completely, be canceled from the radio, or find another place to be staged.
Another decision was made. The show had to move. So began a transitional period in the Opry's history. Between 1934 and 1943, it was a show without a real home. Like a cast of hobos, the Opry moved from stage to stage. First to the Hillsboro Theater on the west side of town. Then to an old revival hall, the Dixie Tabernacle. And then back downtown to the War Memorial Auditorium. In spite of this transient existence, it was also a period of enormous growth and change. Most notably, the musicians who came to the Opry were less amateur and more professional. Music was a livelihood, not a hobby. And everyone began to recognize that an appearance on the Opry could make an entire career.
If you're on the Grand Ole Opry, why, everybody looks up to you and respects you and always complimenting you on it.
In 1936, Pee Wee King's Golden West Cowboys joined the Opry. They brought a new flavor and look to the show, Western. Then, between 1938 and 1940, three more new performers appeared, who clearly represented a changing of the guard at the Grand Ole Opry. The first was Roy Acuff.
Mr. Acuff was the kindest man I've ever known in my life. Always working to do something for the underdog and for his fellow man. He was a great man.
Oddly, Acuff was invited to the Opry by the general manager of WSM, not by George D. Hay.
Judge Hay never did like Roy Acuff. He listened to him a couple of times and thought he was awful. But one of the problems was that Roy in those days thought of himself as a fiddler. And when he tried out on the Opry, he was up against some of the greatest fiddlers in the country. And Acuff simply wasn't that much of a fiddler. And so Judge Hay had turned him down. Well, when he tried out in February of 1938, one of his band members said, Roy, why don't you try singing a song instead of fiddling?
That night, Roy Acuff sang a song called The Great Speckled Bird. Listeners loved it.
What a
of all I am thinking concerning a great speckled bird.
Within a couple of days, bushels of mail started coming in. And within a week, Roy had received a telegram saying, "We want you on the Opry."
It's really Roy Acuff, that penetrating, mountain, mournful wail going out over the airwaves in 1938 that really changes everything. He was the show's biggest star within a year. Just by singing The Great Speckled Bird and The Wabash Cannonball and those songs, that just, he felt it so deeply. He had such soul in his voice.
On the wings of that great speckled bird.
A little more than a year after Acuff's debut came the biggest change of all. The NBC radio network decided to broadcast a half-hour portion of the Grand Ole Opry to the entire nation. The show's sponsor was Prince Albert Tobacco, and its star was Roy Acuff.
Prince Albert, the National Joy Smoke, presents your Grand Ole Opry.
The Prince Albert Grand Ole Opry debuted on October 14, 1939. Within 2 weeks, it introduced another new star, a mandolin picker from Kentucky named Bill Monroe.
Well, it's Bill Monroe and his bluegrass boys all ready to dish out their second helping on the Grand Ole Opry. These hoedown experts have an old breakdown.
Bill Monroe, I think, is probably the most talented individual that ever came through the gates of the city of Nashville. He is such an important figure in American music. If you look at Louis Armstrong and you look at Muddy Waters or Robert Johnson or Bing Crosby or someone that really made a change in American music, Bill Monroe would have to be right up there with all those people.
Bill Monroe came to the Grand Ole Opry in 1939. That great watershed year. He auditioned on a Monday afternoon. And afterwards, as Monroe himself loved to say, Judge Hay took him aside and said, "You've got a job at the Opry, and if you ever leave, you'll have to fire yourself."
The third star to change the Opry and set its course for future decades was neither a singer nor a picker. Her name, Sarah Ophelia Cannon, a Nashville socialite who came down from the pillars of high society to become famous and beloved as Cousin Minnie Pearl.
This is the Prince Albert Grand Ole Opry, and everybody's happy in the Ole Opry House. If you're still wondering if it's true that red and yeller catch feller, it oughtn't to be long before you find out. Here's the pride of Grinder's Switch, all diked out in red and yellow, Miss Minnie Pearl. How about it, Minnie Pearl? Have you caught a feller yet?
Well, sir, howdy. I'm just as proud to be here. I'm just as proud I could come.
I loved Minnie Pearl. I loved her dearly, and I think she loved me because we always swapping little stories and... We were close, very, very close, and what a wonderful lady.
If I had to pick somebody who just kind of epitomized the Opry for me, at least the Opry that I grew up with, it'd be Minnie Pearl.
Minnie Pearl was the Grand Ole Opry, and the Opry was Minnie Pearl. I mean, they were, you know.
Minnie Pearl joined the Opry cast in November 1940. Within weeks, she was a recognizable star on the show.
Well, I think, as most people know, Minnie Pearl was not the simple-minded country girl that she played. She, in fact, was a well-trained actress. She was a graduate of Belmont College.
Minnie's character was carefully constructed to fit the hillbilly stereotype that Judge Hay had created years before. But there was nothing unsophisticated about her humor.
I just want to tell you that
tell you, I think you're the most attractive person I've ever met.
Oh, well, now that's different, Minnie, in case you feel like that, honey.
I think you are, without a shadow of a doubt, the most attractive person I've ever met.
Well, thank you so much, Minnie. That's real nice of you, honey, and I just wish I could say the same about you.
Well, you could if you told as big a lie as I did.
Oh.
With these stars in place, and a national radio audience listening every week, the Grand Ole Opry had established itself as the home of country music. And yet, it still didn't have a home of its own.
The Grand Ole Opry, 75 years of America's music, continues in a moment on A&E. It's in the Grand Ole Opry, 75 years of America's music on A&E.
By the beginning of summer 1943, the Grand Ole Opry and its stars were known worldwide. Roy Acuff was as famous as Babe Ruth. Uncle Dave Makin was still knocking them dead with his banjo. Minnie Pearl had them in stitches with her down-home humor. Bill Monroe tore up the house every show. And a newcomer, Ernest Tubb, the Texas troubadour, literally electrified the Opry when he brought an electric guitar to the show. George D. Hay didn't always approve of all the changes going on. Keep it simple, he liked to say. But his little radio program, heard every Saturday night, had become the undisputed king of the barn dance shows. All this brought power and prestige to the Opry and its owners, WSM and the National Life and Accident Insurance Company. But for all its successes, they still had a problem. The Opry needed a permanent home. In 1939, the executives of WSM and National Life were pleased when the Opry moved into Nashville's War Memorial Auditorium.
That move was an interesting one because the War Memorial Auditorium had been dedicated to the finer things.
Now, it was considered a high-class venue. This is where the soldiers' reunions were held, where the symphony played, and this kind of stuff.
Well, the Opry suddenly being in there made the auditorium start to become shabby because huge crowds of people were coming through there every week, and the crowds were not your classical music enthusiasts that were dressed in evening wear.
The Opry audience was very uncouth. They spit tobacco, and they put chewing gum under the seats, and the overseers of the facility said, out, get out.
So it was from there that the Opry moved to the Ryman Auditorium in 1943.
Amazing grace, how sweet
the sound. Well, I love the Ryman. You know, there have been many of a great man and woman walked on the stage of the Ryman.
Has got a certain touch. When you walk go in that building, the feeling you get is it's just absolutely different than any other building I've ever been in to this day. And I don't know what it is.
The acoustics at the Ryman are so great. It was a joy to go out there and just sing, you know, one microphone was middle of the stage. It was just a joy to know that they could hear you without the PA system. The magic about that old building.
Absolutely. The Ryman is the mother church of country music.
If the Ryman looked like a church and sounded like a church, it's because that's what it was, a church. And the music of the Opry just seemed to be a perfect fit right from the beginning.
The music came from the hills, came from the churches. A lot of people talk about, you know, the bars and the clubs where all this music came from. They don't realize that 90% of country music came out of the churches.
The first performance of the Grand Ole Opry at the Ryman Auditorium was in June 1943. And it was broadcast live, not just on WSM, but over the entire NBC radio network. The acoustics were perfect, but little else. The audience sat in the original wooden church pews, which were very uncomfortable. In the summer, it was unbearably hot.
Even with all the windows open, it was still, on a summer night, incredibly hot. And you could hear the street if you were sitting in the Ryman with the windows open, as well as hear the show. And the sound of the music would spill out onto the street for folks passing by. The coal smoke from the city would filter in through the windows, and then as the spotlights came on, you would see that smoky appearance. And Grant Turner used to like to describe the scene as being one of blue smoke, because of the smoke coming in off the streets and the dust in the Ryman Auditorium, and those spotlights shining down gave this kind of eerie blue cast to the Ryman Auditorium audience area. And then the popcorn and the peanuts and all of that sort of thing just created a very rustic atmosphere for the Grand Ole Opry, which I think became part of the show's charm over time.
Backstage at the Ryman was something else. It was small and extremely crowded, and there weren't enough dressing rooms.
You'd think ladies first, right? Well, the boys had the dressing room.
I remember that the only dressing room we women had at the old Ryman was the ladies' bathroom. And I want to say, as best I remember, it had three or four stalls. And I think three or four sinks, and it was little.
You don't want to know what it was like to be in the bathroom dressing. You don't want to know what us girls did. That's where we told all of our secrets and everything else, you know.
I remember one night in particular, they maybe wouldn't appreciate me sharing it, but it's a beautiful memory of mine that I love and treasure. But I remember we were in there sitting on toilets and leaning up against sinks and standing around the room. And it was Dolly Parton, and it was Loretta, Jeannie Seely, and we had the best visit. And I mean, how... how down home is that, sitting on potties? You know what I'm saying?
One night, we won't name no names, but there's one of the girls, the two of us had something to say about, and she was in the bathroom and we didn't know it. She turned loose on us, though, when we got through talking.
The Ryman, for all its quirks and idiosyncrasies, was immediately accepted by artists, fans, and management alike. And for the next 30 years, it was home to the Grand Ole Opry, the mother church of country music.
The Grand Ole Opry, 75 years of America's music, continues in a moment on A&E.
75 years of America's music on A&E.
If the golden years of country music started after World War II, then WSM's Grand Ole Opry was the gold mine. With 20 years of tradition behind it, along with 50,000 watts of broadcasting power at 650 on the AM radio dial, the Opry wasn't just the biggest show in Nashville. It was a top-rated program in America. To be a country star, you had to play the Opry.
You never make it till you hit the Grand Ole Opry, because it is the greatest show on earth when it comes to country music. I mean, why else is bigger?
It has always been important to that young artist, and it still is today.
In the 1940s and 50s, the Opry was the dominant force in every artist's career.
You have to remember, there's no television. Radio is everything. And in that day and time, radio's audience was vast. You used the Opry basically to build your popularity, your name, to get your songs known. There was no such thing as a country record-spinning format. I mean, this is how you popularized your material, was through these broadcasts. You wanted to get on that network broadcast and be heard coast to coast.
A good measure of the Opry's power was its ability to draw sponsors, and that became part of the show. commercials were often performed by members of the cast, and they were fun. Companies from Purina to Pet Milk to Martha White to Royal Crown Cola all lined up to sponsor half-hour segments of the show, which ran from 7 p.m. to midnight every weekend, rain or shine. To keep sponsors happy, Opry management didn't rest on past laurels. They revered tradition, the roots of the Opry's success, but they also recognized the need to stay current, in tune to the music of the day and the growing business around it.
Any institution that's been around for as long as the Grand Ole Opry's been in existence always has to deal with the issue of staying relevant.
During and immediately following World War II, the Opry went on a massive talent drive to attract all of what were then the hot hunks of the day to its cast. Eddie Arnold, Hank Williams, Ernest Tubb, Hank Snow. All of these superstars came in one giant move by the show within a 10-year period.
One of the first big changes came with Bob Wills and his Texas Playboys. In December 1944, Wills brought drums to the stage of the Grand Ole Opry. This bucked tradition and caused a ruckus with Opry brass. But Wills infused new energy into the show. About the same time, another new sound was under construction, created by the hands of Bill Monroe.
Bill experimented with his sound, trying to find some kind of innovative personal style. And when he hired Lester Flatt and Earl Scruggs in 1945, he found it.
It was a new type of American music, and it was brought about directly on the stage of the Grand Ole Opry.
The Grand Ole Opry, especially at the Ryman Auditorium, holds very, very special meaning because that was really the first place that this music that we know of today as bluegrass, that's the first place that music was heard.
That was a golden era, not just for the Opry, but for the artists that were being signed to do the show. Roy Acuff, Minnie Pearl, Bill Monroe, Ernest Tubb, Red Foley in 1946 joined the cast. And all of these things combined to bring a level of excitement to the Grand Ole Opry that hadn't been there previously. Into all this walked Hank Williams.
I got a feeling called the blues.
I was there the night that Hank Williams made his first guest appearance.
When Hank walked out in that beautifully tailored white suit and walked into those spotlights, it was just more than the crowd could take. They just roared.
I think he did six encores.
Encores at the Grand Ole Opry were unheard of anyway. And this man did six because they could not get the audience quieted.
Hank Williams had a magnetism that was hard to explain. No one understood it. When he came on, he just electrified the audience. And they wouldn't let him off, you know. He was always had to be the closer on the show.
And yet, as big a star as Hank Williams became, and as important as he was to country music, he wasn't bigger than the Opry. In 1951, when drinking and personal troubles tarnished his star, Hank started missing shows.
One of the rules back during the period when I joined was you had to be there at least 20 Saturdays a year.
The Opry, because of its growing responsibility to fans and sponsors, couldn't suffer transgressions.
They pretty well are to the point where in the 1950s, they can take the hottest act in country music, Hank Williams, and with impunity fire him because he's not towing the line with the Opry regulations, and he's not staying sober for the shows. And they are strong enough that they can do that.
The Opry demanded a certain family image of its cast members. And when Hank began binging too much, they told him he had to go.
Lord, I'm nobody's sugar daddy now, and I'm lonesome. I got the lovesick blues.
He went back to a Louisiana hayride and died just months afterwards. He always had friends in the cast. I mean, many of the people that he worked with, you know, grieved for him, but they couldn't change the boss's decisions, you know. So he went.
If the Opry was rocked by Hank Williams, it persevered, only to be rocked again in October of 1954. That's when another young rebel made his first and last appearance on the Opry. His name? Elvis Presley.
It was very, very early in his career. And he only, I think he had out the one record, Blue Moon of Kentucky. And not too much response.
Elvis honored Bill Monroe by covering the bluegrass standard. But the Opry audience and management didn't think much of Presley's act or his future in country music.
Oh, 6 months from that time, he was hot as a firecracker.
The Opry, however, never looked back. It was stronger than ever and wasn't short on new acts. In a relatively short period during the early 1950s, it welcomed many new faces and made them stars. Kitty Wells in 1952. Marty Robbins in 1953.
Out in the West Texas town of El Paso, but the Mexican girl. Nighttime would find me in Rose's Cantina. Music would play and Polino would pull.
In 1955, Jim Reeves appeared, along with Gene Shepherd and Hawkshaw Hawkins. And a brash young ruffian in 1956, Johnny Cash.
I keep a close watch on this heart of mine. I keep my eyes wide open all the time. I keep the ends out for the tie that binds. Because you're mine, I walk the line.
More than any other artist of the decade, Cash openly defied the Opry while embracing it at the same time. His performances are among the most memorable in country music history. But his tenure as a cast member was short-lived. In 1958, Johnny Cash quit the Opry cast to pursue more lucrative career options. The Opry didn't know it yet, but its power over artists was beginning to slip, and its influence beginning to change.
Because you're mine, I walk the line.
The Grand Ole Opry, 75 years of America's music, continues in a moment on A&E.
75 years of America's music on A&E.
By the 1950s, the Grand Ole Opry had come a long way. Electric guitars and honky-tonk stars had made it one of the most successful radio shows in history. Along with that came change. First, the gentle shedding of the hillbilly image, and second, the role women had to play. Women have always been a large part of the Opry cast, but it was not until the appearance of Kitty Wells in 1952 that a woman became a star of the Opry.
Well, Kitty Wells is the originator for opened the doors for all the lady singers.
Kitty Wells became an inspiration to many women who became Opry stars.
It's no wonder to me that they're as popular as they are, because we have such great talent with Loretta Lynn and, of course, Tammy Wynette, and Laurie Morgan is another. She's raised kind of on the stage of the Grand Ole Opry.
Laurie's father, George Morgan, joined the Opry cast in 1948. When Laurie was born in 1959, he was a favorite on the show, and she became a daughter of the Opry family.
I am a daughter of the Opry and very proud to be. You know, I was practically born and raised backstage at the Grand Ole Opry, and it's something that means a lot to me.
Laurie's birth coincided with the arrival of another new member at the Opry, a woman whose influence cannot be easily measured. Patsy Cline first appeared on the Grand Ole Opry. She was introduced by Little Jimmy Dickens and Ernest Tubb.
Well, thank you, Ernest. I'd like to do one of my favorites that I recorded some time back. A church, a courtroom, and then goodbye.
Patsy several years to get her career going, but in 1960, her enormous talent was finally recognized, and she was asked to join the Opry. After that, her star became the brightest in the sky.
She meant it. Listen to those records. It's like she is pouring everything into those records, and it's beautiful.
I hate the sight of that courtroom.
They're great, great records. That is still the standard against which every female vocalist in country music must measure themselves.
Patsy was not just a big female star. In an era when the show was being dominated by men, she became the Opry's top act.
You have to remember that women did not headline shows in those days, and she did. She was top billed on her live performances, and no other woman had ever done that. She was big.
Patsy always told me that we're going to be bigger than the guys in Nashville anyway. That was Patsy's words. Oh, we're going to make it bigger than the guys anyway, she said. So I believed anything she told me, and that's the way it was.
In 1961, Patsy Cline headlined a cast of Grand Ole Opry stars that went to New York City and played Carnegie Hall. It was a sellout. On that trip, the New York papers played up the Opry's hillbilly image, which the show continued to perpetuate, but the artists quietly scorned.
I think in the early days, any country entertainer that went to New York City or to Los Angeles, the first thing you'd see is hay bales, and they got treated like country hicks and country cousins. Ernest Tubb said this. He said, "You can call me a hillbilly, but you better smile when you do it. But in a case like somebody like me, it's kind of a badge of honor because I'm proud to be a hillbilly singer.
Still, it was not just hillbilly music anymore. The Opry had grown to represent and echo the beating heart of America. From the misty mountains of Appalachia to the cactus-covered prairies of the West. Little Jimmy Dickens, Porter Wagoner, and Marty Robbins were revolutionizing the mournful beauty of the Western ballad. And Loretta Lynn tapping the soul of a Kentucky coal mine.
I walked away from the wreck of our love affair, and no one knew how I was hurt because I lied. I walked away from the wreck, but it broke my heart, and I'm all smashed up and broken.
Finally, when Daddy got his job in the coal mines, he bought a little Philco radio. And so on Saturday night, we listened to the Grand Ole Opry. And I would go to sleep every Saturday night, curled up by the radio.
Let her go, boys.
Ernest Tubb was my favorite all-time star. When he would sing, I would cry. And I loved Roy Acuff. And, you know, Kitty Wells.
Loretta Lynn made her Opry debut in October 1960.
And Ernest Tubb brought me on stage, and I sang Honky Tonk Girl, and it was during the Pet Milk. I'll never forget it because I look back. I remember, you know, when something like this happens to you, you never forget it. I don't remember singing. I remember patting my foot to the song. That's all. And I remember running off the stage in the hall, and I've been on the Grand Ole Opry. That was a big deal, and it still is.
Waiting in the wings to welcome her and become her friend was Patsy Cline.
I bonded one on the, you know, with one, and that was Patsy.
In March 1963, tragedy struck the Opry. Four cast members, including Hawkshaw Hawkins, Cowboy Copas, and Patsy Cline perished in a plane crash. The news shocked the Opry.
It's a hard time in Nashville because look at the artists that died when Patsy died. And on the way to the funeral, Jack, Kitty Wells' brother, that sang with Johnny and Jack, he was killed coming to the funeral. And while they were preaching the funeral, they come in and told Kitty and Johnny, your brother is dead, you know. It was quite a hard time.
If ever the Ryman felt like a church, it was Saturday night, March 9th, 1963. There, in the mother church of country music, the Opry cast came together as a family in mourning and in healing.
I think we all pulled together more and got closer. And we at least told each other how we felt about each other, and I think that was something good come out of it. Whether there was nothing else in this world, but that was something good.
Just a year later, Jim Reeves died in a plane crash outside Nashville. Another terrible blow.
The Opry, I think, is a family because when something happens to one of us, it's really a drastic thing. It really hits us hard, you know.
The 1960s brought a peculiar challenge to the Grand Ole Opry: how to deal with rock and roll. Despite token guest appearances by artists such as the Byrds and James Brown, management said what it always said: keep it simple. This remained the guiding policy of the Opry, and they weren't about to change. Into the breach stepped a whole new generation of Grand Ole Opry stars who abided tradition and cherished their roots. but nonetheless ushered change in many different ways and made the Opry better. Willie Nelson, Dottie West, Tex Ritter, Tammy Wynette, Dolly Parton, Connie Smith, Jeannie Seeley.
Probably one of my biggest influences here at the Opry was Jeannie Seeley. To me, Jeannie was, she was cool. She was hip. She was beautiful. She stood on her own two feet. She said what she felt. Still does to this day, I might add.
Jeannie and other women of the Opry always dreamed of hosting a portion of the show. But like rock and roll, that wasn't always part of the program.
Change comes hard in a lot of things, and especially in a job like ours where there's so much emotion connected with it, I think, ties to history. I know I kept poking there again, pushing for these doors to be open for women. When I asked, what is needed to be... to host a portion. And they said two things. You have to have gained enough name and, you know, stardom, so to speak, and you have to be a man. And I just tucked it back in my head and thought, okay. Doing the job was not that important. Being given the chance and the opportunity to do it was that important. Most important was being denied the opportunity.
Women would eventually get that opportunity, with Jean Shepherd, Jeannie Pruitt, and Jeannie Seeley leading the way. But in the late 1960s, this was not the most serious issue facing the Grand Ole Opry. The greatest crisis of all was the Mother Church itself, the Ryman Auditorium. The Opry's cherished home had become a dangerous place to host the show.
Because look at what you had. You had this Ryman Auditorium, which was not in really great shape in 1943, and by 1967 or 68 was practically falling down. Every time they turned the lights on, they would be afraid the place would catch fire.
Compounding this, downtown Nashville was in decay.
They were surrounded by dirty movie houses and panhandlers and hookers. And if you stood in line to get an Opry ticket down there, I mean, you could get hit by pickpockets and everything.
It was a bad situation. So a lot of discussion was held about what to do about the Grand Ole Opry. And is it time to just abandon it? That maybe it has outlived its usefulness by now.
A decision was made. They would move. In the fall of 1971, construction began on a new Opry House east of downtown. By 1974, it was ready. Moving the Opry wasn't a popular decision, but it was the only decision that would keep the show going. And what nobody knew was how well it would go at the new Opry House.
The Grand Ole Opry, 75 years of America's music, continues in a moment on A&E. 5 years of America's music on A&E.
Well, sir, for the last song that I'll get to sing in this old building, I'd like to do the first one that I ever sang in this old building back in September of 1948, Candy Christmas.
Sang the last song at the old Ryman prior to the night before they moved to this wonderful house here. And he sang Candy Kisses, signed off the air, and said, we'll see you tomorrow night at the new Opry House.
In the brand new one out at Opryland. George Barker, ladies and gentlemen.
Well, it was almost the last song. After Morgan signed off, about midnight, Friday, March 15th, 1974, Johnny Cash appeared on the stage, along with the Carter family and many Opry cast members. Together, they joined hands for one more song in the Mother Church of Country Music, an old gospel tune, Will the Circle Be Unbroken? The next night, the Opry cast gathered at Opryland, USA, to formally open the brand new Grand Ole Opry House.
We wanted to have the entire Opry roster there. We wanted all the talent to be there. Best of my knowledge, I think they all were there at that time.
I went out in the audience. I wanted to be in the audience when the curtain went up. And I have never in my life been as moved by anything. They had a movie screen, and it showed an old vintage clip from back in the 30s of Roy Acuff and the Smoky Mountain Boys playing and singing the Wabash Cannonball.
She's the combination on the Wabash Cannonball. Our eastern states are dandies, so the people all...
And then slowly, slowly the curtain began to rise. And behind the curtain, Roy Acuff and his Smoky Mountain Boys were playing and singing the Wabash Cannonball. I saw the tears streaming down my face. It was absolutely the most beautiful, emotional thing that I've ever been a part of.
It was an exciting night for many reasons.
The overriding part of the excitement was that we had invited the President of the United States to come to the grand opening. And he came, much to our surprise. And he was magnificent.
Ladies and gentlemen, the President of the United States and Mrs. Nixon.
First, Nixon said a few words.
First, country music is America. It started here. It's ours. It isn't something that we learned from some other nation. It isn't something that we inherited. It relates to those experiences that mean so much to America. Country music radiates a love of this nation. It's good for Americans to hear it. We come away better from having heard it. Thank you very much.
After the speech, Nixon surprised everyone and played the piano. And then the fun began. Nixon produced a yo-yo from his pocket.
We're not in any hurry. He don't need to get back up there quick anyway. We need him down here for a while. Now.
And Roy Acuff gave him an impromptu lesson on stage.
Now jerk your butt.
I'll stay here and try to learn how to use the yo-yo. You'll go up and be president, bro.
At a time when Nixon faced impeachment in Washington, it was a priceless moment. And only Roy Acuff could have pulled it off.
This is the one he gave me. He didn't know it'd work that way.
I think Roy Acuff was one of those people that kind of helped set the standard around here. Acuff was an ambassador. He was kind of the captain of the ship, somebody we all looked to. Acuff was the kind of guy who could hang out with the most common farmer. But at the same time, presidents or heads of state, you know, he was totally at home with them.
One of the highlights...
Nixon had a great time, then went home to face the music in Washington. Roy Acuff, on the other hand, was already home. Backstage in dressing room number one. There, for the next 20 years, the king of country presided over the music he loved.
In his dressing room, the door was always open. Anybody could come in. He loved to have music playing in his room, and I'd go in and play for him. He liked picking.
Well, the backstage environment is half the show. It's organized chaos, is what I've heard it called so many times.
A regular concert date where you control the backstage and you meet who you want and don't meet who you want. And it's crazy out here some weekends. It's just nuts, you know, but it's part of the charm of it.
Show to me. That's the fun part. Giving Buck White a mandolin, letting him play with the band, or having one of the fiddle players come and set in back there with us. That's a fun, one of the fun parts of the Grand Ole Opry.
It's all been about fun. You know, forget the money, forget career statements. It's all about bringing an entertaining moment to a radio show. And the fun factor is usually really high out here.
Now, what's your daughter's name?
Heather.
Besides all the fun backstage, the new Opry House invigorated the show in unforeseen ways. First, the stage itself had a surprise. That circle of wood cut from the old stage of the Ryman. Here, a new generation of country artists could stand, like those before them.
And in my opinion, when you stand in the middle of that circle, it gives you license to sing any country song ever written, thought of, or performed.
Right behind the circle, a full drum set, a nod to change. That was added mostly because there was room on the new Opry stage. Artists like Marty Robbins brought other instruments to the stage, such as horns. For the Grand Ole Opry, this represented flexibility in the delicate balance between tradition and change, between keeping it simple and keeping it current. It was in this atmosphere that a new breed of country artist was able to emerge on the Opry, the superstar. One cast member who helped blaze that trail was Dolly Parton. In 1974, Dolly left Porter Wagoner's band to go out on her own. By doing so, she paved the road for many who followed. All through the 1970s and 80s, new superstars emerged on the country scene and came to the Opry stage. Alabama, Randy Travis, Clint Black, Reba, and Garth. All these artists and more brought new glory to the great hallowed stage of the Grand Ole Opry.
Thank you very much.
The Grand Ole Opry, 75 years of America's music. Continue America's music on A&E.
Great time here at the Grand Ole Opry right now, and a great pleasure I have to introduce the next act to come out here. And this is one of the truly great singers, great entertainers of our time today. One of the best I feel like there is in the country music business. My pleasure to introduce him to all of you here at the Grand Ole Opry tonight and all over the country. Ladies and gentlemen, Travis Tritt!
A true highlight in any country artist's career is being asked to join the cast of the Grand Ole Opry.
It's, I think, one of the highest honors that a country music artist could be given, to be invited to be a part of one of the greatest institutions that our business has to offer.
Along with Travis Tritt, other new members in the 1990s included Clint Black, Martina McBride, Alan Jackson, Trisha Yearwood, Steve Warren, Marty Stewart, and Vince Gill.
Thank you. Do you guys mind if I just stand here for a minute and take a picture of this? This is my first time. To me, it's the kind of honor that gives you the opportunity to really be a part of the history of country music, not just be a popular artist for a short period of time and have a few hit records, because this place is timeless and because it is reverent for what has gone on before, and those people are still every bit as important as the new artists.
Thank you very much. Vince, if I was to turn around and leave right now, I'd get shot, because I haven't asked you to do your big number, and I want you to do it. If you don't do it, I'll get shot before I get off the stage.
I have a lot of very, very favorite personal moments. One I would share with everyone is one night when Roy Acuff was here at the Opry, and about 2 years or 3 years before he passed away, he'd asked Vince Gill to sing his favorite song.
I've rushed home from work like I always do. I spend my whole day just thinking of you.
Well, Vince sang this song for Roy on the Opry. Roy watched Vince and listened to him while he sang that song.
Cause nobody answered when I called your name. Note on the table.
It was one of the greatest performances I've ever seen done, one-on-one. And it was a marvelous moment.
Roy Acuff claimed it his favorite song he ever heard, and really was the reason I got to come here.
Every member of the Grand Ole Opry, that's the charm. It's a place where generations meet. where young artists perform with bona fide legends.
No other genre of music celebrates the legends, the contemporary stars, and showcases the new artists all on one stage.
That's what's beautiful. There's room for the traditional, the mountain music, Wilma Lee Cooper, who comes out. She is the queen of the folk mountain music.
Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. The multi-talented, lovely lady by the name of Miss Barbara Mandrell. Give her a nice applause.
I'm in awe of everyone that's a member of the Opry. I know I am a fan of the Opry, and I'll always be.
You've mentioned names like Patsy and Loretta and Tammy and Connie and Jeannie and all the greats that have stood on this stage. There's one more we're fixing to add to it. She's come home now. She's come home now. How about it? Y'all stand up and say hi to my sister, Pam Tillis. Come here, sis.
When Pam Tillis was inducted as a member of the Grand Ole Opry, it was like coming home.
I'm excited about being elected a member in 2000 because that sounds kind of futuristic, you know. I'm not thinking entirely about where the Opry's been. I'm kind of thinking where it's going. And that excites me.
Looking back, all I can say about all the things he did for me. Is I hope I'm at least half the dad that he didn't have to be.
Brad Paisley. Probably everybody's hands-on favorite of what's coming up and young.
Every girl that's now my wife, about 3 years ago.
Brad is the guy that is kind of carrying that torch of perhaps some traditional country music.
And now here I stand surrounded by our family and friends, crowded round the nursery window as they bring the baby.
Brad Paisley is one of the greatest little guys right now. I think that he'll be a big star. He's already a star, but he's going to be a great star. He's going to be much greater.
Looking through the glass, I think about the man standing next to me. And I hope I'm at least
with so many dedicated and talented artists spanning three generations of America's musical heritage, the Opry's future is bright.
This is my 33rd year here. And I stop every now and then and say, you know, this is really something to be accepted in this unique group.
You see a lot of artists that know and understand that heritage, you know, and they really respect it. And I think the fans do, too. I think they understand that this is an important part of history, you know, not only just music history, but broadcasting and history in general.
Performers that come to mind that understand the importance of the Opry and what it's about and are there, in my opinion, because of that reverence and that respect for who came before are people like Steve Warner, Vince Gill, Alison Krauss, Garth Brooks. They understand the importance and they have a great respect for that place when they step in the door.
And you say you'd be happy.
I've always believed that as an Opry member, that's part of your responsibility. You should support the Opry every time you get a chance. And I'm probably guilty as much as anybody of at least feeling guilty anyway about the fact that I don't perform it enough. You know, I should be there probably every Saturday night, quite frankly.
Yeah.
all I do is say, we'd love to have you. It sure be great if you'd come out and see us once in a while. I'm just saying, this works for me, you know, and they can count on me being out here for the rest of my life. You know, this is a great home.
I think about people like Ricky Skaggs, Alan Jackson, Patti Loveless, Travis Tritt, Mike Snyder, Lori Morgan, Pam Tillis. You know, we all have that Opry thing in our heart because we're Opry brats. We were raised around it or raised loving it. And that combined with the legends and, you know, the mainstays out here, that makes for a pretty powerful future.
For everyone associated with the Opry, the members, management, crew, and most important, the fans. The bottom line is pretty simple. This is the music of America.
The Opry means more to me than I could ever explain to anybody. And every time I'm out there, I think of my dad.
I could go on and on about the Grand Ole Opry, what it means to me. I'm a country music fan. And Grand Ole Opry, that's the mother church of country music.
I think the Grand Ole Opry will go down in the history books of country music as one of the greatest shows that has ever been. Proof of that is 75 years of it and still going.
I tell people that there are very few things that are just truly American that you should see one time, whether you like it or not. And whether you like country music or not, there's only one Grand Ole Opry. And it's an experience like no other, and everybody ought to experience it.
Every country has their thing, and I think the Grand Ole Opry is for America. I think that stands for America. That's my opinion about the Grand Ole Opry. She is America.
Delighted. This is WSM Nashville, Tennessee, presenting the Grand Ole Opry. Let her go, boys.
As long as people love the Grand Ole Opry, and as long as people tune it in every Friday and Saturday night, as long as people keep listening to it, we're going to keep playing. I was fortunate enough to become a member of the Grand Ole Opry in 1990. It'll always be the highlight of my career. Every time I step out on the stage, every time I see it on TV or hear it on the radio, I'm humbled by the company that it keeps. Full of respect for those who stood here, and so thankful for the opportunity that those people gave me and those like me that followed. It's a very special piece of American history. It's the Grand Ole Opry, the mother church of country music. I'm Garth Brooks. Thanks for watching.
The Grand Ole Opry has been brought to you in part by Liberty Mutual Insurance and by the Burlington Coat Factory.
High performance.